We recently got a cat.
Sounds like a confession.
We got a cat after like 8 years of saying that I would never submit myself to such torture. We have a cat. And the cat's kind of fun. I'll admit it. The kitten is fun. The kitten attacks and keeps our home safe from all the dust bunnies that come in. The kitten is real good at playing with the catnip. The kitten is good at grabbing whatever toy, or maybe acorn, or maybe sock, and it nibbles on it because the sock has a toe in it still. Fun cat. You can't even tell if that was sarcastic or not. So, the other day, my wife texts me and she says, I think the cat's been climbing on the window screen, like climbing up in the window. And I'm just like, well, I know that she's pretty athletic, but I don't know how that would work. Like, they have pretty big windows. How are they going to hold themselves up? And I don't think so. She says, yeah, well, there's a couple holes in the screen. I think, okay, holes in the screen. Maybe it's bugs. I don't know, some kind of like termites that walk the screens. That's probably what it is. Or maybe a bird ran into it. I don't have to tape the screen, but we'll fix it. She says, no, it's the cat. And I say, well, how do you know it's the cat, though? How do you know that it's the cat? Prove it. How do you know that it's the cat? And she texts back this. Eyewitnesses are really important. Eyewitnesses get their eyesight on an event that's taking place, like in news stories. Eyewitnesses are important because they tell us what has happened. Eyewitnesses are the difference between a fairy tale and reality, the difference between nonfiction and then fiction, the difference between a lie and truth. When it comes to the resurrection of Jesus, which, I kid you not, all of Christian faith hinges on this truth. When it comes to the resurrection of Jesus, this isn't something that you and I can go see Jesus today, see how he's doing visually for ourselves. It happened 2,000 years ago. Eyewitnesses are key in proving that truth. This sermon series is called Eyewitness Account. Start today, come to the next couple of weeks. What we're going to do is we're going to take a look from the scriptures at the eyewitness accounts. What did they see? Why were they convinced that Jesus rose from the dead? The goal of this series is that you become more convinced. Your faith grows, your faith expands, your confidence becomes positive of Jesus' resurrection and truth. Asking questions along the way, guiding God in Scripture, guiding our hearts. Before we go to the very first account we'll look at today, let's say a prayer and ask God to bless us. Oh Lord, strengthen us this morning by the truth. Your word is the truth. Open our eyes to see what you want us to see. Open our ears to hear what you want us to hear, and open our hearts to believe what you would have us believe. Amen.
Amen.
So the first resurrection eyewitness account we'll look at from the latter part of John chapter 20, starting at verse 10. If you want to look it up on your own, you can find it in your worship folder too. It's an eyewitness account of a woman called Mary Magdalene, which I think she's probably one of the best known people in the Bible, characters in the Bible. But that's interesting because Mary Magdalene, she doesn't have a lot of pages that cover her life. Like, she's not there for a good portion of Jesus' ministry. She doesn't have a lot of stories about her until really you get to his death and resurrection. Then suddenly she plays this really big part. So if we're trying to understand who Mary Magdalene is, right? We're trying to understand who exactly Mary Magdalene is. She's called Magdalene because the area that she resided also helped distinguish her from the like 54 other Marys that are in the Bible. Mary Magdalene, we'll go to Mark chapter 16, and here's about all they know prior to her interaction with Jesus. It says, Mary Magdalene, out of whom? Seven demons. Which, that's not even a sentence, right? Like, she doesn't have, like, a full sentence. Her first introduction is just a passing comment. It's an adjectival commentary in the Bible. What do you learn from it? So she's got these seven demons. What's that? Well, the Bible talks about angels, also fallen angels. That's where the god devil comes from, anyone who followed him. This is not a good thing. Generally speaking, scholars will talk about this. This is something that would take place when someone turned to take practice in the occult, or maybe some drug use, kind of going down this almost satanic-like path. I say that because if Mary's done some of this stuff in her past, that's important for us to understand for what's going to happen to her, right? She's doing almost like the exact opposite. Even people who want nothing to do with God will generally say, yeah, but it probably don't want anything to do with the devil either. And yet this is what's happened. And as a result, she's kind of lost her faculties. Like, she's not in control of herself. Whether you have your own demons or whatever, think about this, right? Not able to always do what she wants. It's almost like something else is controlling her, almost like other voices are in her head. She's imprisoned. She's alone. She feels guilty. She feels ashamed. She's ostracized. She's the type of person that people are going downtown Raleigh, and they're like, yeah, hot kids, hold my hand. We got to walk away from her. That's who Mary Magdalene was. Until Jesus. And I don't know how he did it. We don't have the miracle described for Mary. But if it's anything like any of the other miracles that Jesus does, it's not as if he gives her a magic pill. It's not as if he gives her some essential oils. Be healed. She is. Like, if you've ever had a counselor help you through a tough time, or if you've ever had a pastor help you through a spiritual struggle, or if you've ever had a doctor who's helped you when you thought something was going to be fatal, understand that's the relationship Mary has with Jesus. She's got this connection with him. She's got this love for him. It's the reason she became a follower of his. She would follow him everywhere that she went. Because he had taken her from sadness to joy, from being a prisoner to freedom. From guilt to forgiveness, from hopelessness to hopefulness. Until he died. By horribly nailed violently to a cross, dying for all to see. You know, some of the other disciples, they like ran away. They're not a part of that. There's only a few of them that are mentioned actually being there and watching this. Mary Magdalene's one of them. And as she's watching this, beginning to picture that, the one who had saved here, he's in utter pain, and she can't do anything to help. It's why this was hard for her. It's why early Sunday morning after he died, like early, like get up at 4:30. Is it time yet? Is it a new day yet? It's probably light enough. I don't know. Maybe I should get going. You see, she wanted to go to his tomb. She wanted to get to his grave. Why? Well, to bring on some ointments. It's kind of like the ancient version of flowers on a grave. She hopes that she gets a little bit of closure, gets herself closer to starting to heal because of this loss that has happened. She wants to get there early in the morning because she's sick of feeling just terrible. She wants to get there. So 4:30, 5 o'clock, she gets up, and she runs over to another house, her friend's house. Her name is Mary, too. Mary! Mary!
What? Other Mary?
We gotta go! We gotta get going! It's like the new day! It's Sunday!
Can't you go back to sleep? Let's, like, can we do it at 6:15, maybe 7?
Mary!
Alright. Leave my sandals. Get my clothes. Go grab another friend and let's go.
Early that Sunday morning, they make their way through the streets of Jerusalem, and you got a picture that Mary's kind of doing one of those fast walks. She's trying to contain herself to stay with her friends, but she can't wait to get there. She's trying to get there. It's kind of awkward in the morning, right? It's super quiet. They don't know exactly what to say. They try to make small talk, anything that might keep their eyes and their minds off the thought that they've just lost their Savior. Oh, look at the pretty trees. We gotta get to the tomb. Hey, Mary, did you grab any breakfast? We gotta get to the tomb. Y'all want to stop at the bagel shop before we... No, we gotta get to the tomb. So they get to the garden. The garden where its tomb is, it's outside of Jerusalem, so it's a little bit of a walk. By this moment, sunlight is starting to come up, the darkness is slowly evaporating. And a practical conversation happens. Mary, you were with me when we saw the burial. Do you remember, have you thought any more about how we're going to open up the tomb? Because it's got this big old rock. There's like four soldiers that pushed it in place, right? And they were straining. Now, I've been doing my CrossFit Jerusalem recently, but still, I'm not exactly sure that we're going to be able to push the stone. Who's going to open it for us? Like, have you thought about that? Like, Mary, do we have a plan? Do we need to get sticks? Do we need to get rollers? Did you get your WD-40? How are we going to get this open? How are we going to get inside the... Well, and off of the distance, maybe about 100 feet or so, the tomb is revealed. Only the door doesn't have a stone in front of it anymore. There's a moment of processing. Then, Mary loses it. I can't believe they did that! They took his body, it's probably those Pharisees, the same people that killed him. They couldn't even let it be. They couldn't even give us a chance to heal. They're always rubbing it in our faces. They hated him. They don't have any reason to hate him. I can't believe they did this. I can't believe it. Mary, hold on. Slow down. No! They must have done it. They must have taken his body and done something awful. I can't stand it. And Mary gets up and she bolts out of there. Her friends call after her, but she's sprinting. There's no stopping her. And as she's running, she's dodging trees, jumping over bushes, jumping over logs. She's making her way out of the garden through the streets of Jerusalem. She almost runs into the bagel guy. She's getting on the way home. And as she gets to the house, she gets close next door to where some of the disciples are staying for fear of the Jews. Oh, she's not polite, but she's knocking. She's banging. And here they come. Hey, Peter, get up. Peter, John, get up. They took his body. They did it. They're awful. It's horrible. It's terrible. What happened, Mary? They took his body. His tomb is empty. Go and see. Peter and John, they feel it too. So they get off and they sprint, and Mary tries to take after them, but she's too weak. Slumps on the side of the building and falls into a mess. Maybe 15 minutes of that, she finally stands back up because she didn't have any tears left, you know. Gotta get to the tomb. Like, gotta get to the bottom of this. Jesus helped me, I'll help him this way. She makes her way back to the garden, and now the garden is eerily quiet. No soldiers. Her friends are gone. Peter and John are gone. She makes her way to the tomb. Looks inside. And there, where his body was, two men. First in white. They're glowing. Angelically. One on the head of the bed, one at the foot, in the middle. The clothes that were on Jesus' dead body, sitting there nicely, folded accordingly. And they ask her, "Dear woman, who are you looking for?" "Jesus, his body! Obviously, it's gone! Like, did you guys not, have you not? You guys are not any help at all." And she turns around, and on her way out, she stumbles and falls, yet again, tears starting to fill her eyes, and they replenish, and they hit the floor until someone comes. But Without even looking up, she thinks that must be the gardener. You know what the gardener is probably in cahoots with the Pharisees. I bet you he took it. He had to be the one. He had to be the one. And so she cries out, "What did you do with his body? Hey, you, gardener, sir, where did you put his body? Would you please tell us? What did you do? It is because of you that his tomb is empty." To which the gardener simply says, "Mary." That's a voice she's heard before. That's a voice that she's heard. It's the voice that taught her God's word. It's the voice that told her of God's love. It's the voice that said, "Be healed." Jesus? You're alive? And with that, Jesus isn't the only one alive. So is Mary's hope. There it is. Short. Not a lot of verses. It's Mary's interaction with Jesus, her eyewitness account, the things that she saw, the things that she did when she went there that first Easter morning. Which, by the way, is recorded in John. John, who is in that story, like John's the one who she goes to say, "Hey, the tomb is empty." He gets there, he sees the tomb is empty. We'll talk more about John and his eyewitness stuff in a later sermon, be sure you're here for it. But for now, think about that. He writes it down, and then he writes it down and he puts it out there for everyone to see, because back then, and there's not social media, hashtag Jesus rose from the dead. No, you got to kind of pass on that message. And that letter, or that book, gets passed on, and when it gets to people who know Mary Magdalene, they come up to her, "You saw him?" And she does not say, "Nah, man, that ain't true." It's true! She's not the only one, by the way. I said there's over 500 witnesses. There's over 500. Never in any religious reality has that ever happened in such a public sphere, that their supposed God does just that, an incredible miracle for all to see. Which means what she's speaking is truth, and it means today we've got truth that we need to apply to our lives. Here's three of them. Number one, this ain't hard. Jesus rose. We gotta stop and pause on that, because this is key. Like, if this ain't true, it doesn't matter. And maybe for you, this is the part where you've got some skepticism. I can understand. After all, most people, when they're dead, or you come across a dead body, what does the dead body tend to do? Answer, nothing. Maybe decompose, that's about it. Most dead bodies do nothing. And the thing is, when people are alive, we've been trying to conquer this death thing. And sure, we can restart hearts, and maybe we can get some lungs to breathe with a big iron lung machine for a while, but we have to conquer that. Like, understand this. If we're going to believe that Jesus rose from the dead, that means that Jesus, while he's dead, when most people do nothing while they're dead, he's going to do the one thing that people while they're living have never been able to do. And conquer death. If you're skeptical about this, I can understand, so is Mary Magdalene. Like, how many times does God have to prove it to her, right? She comes to the tomb, it's empty. Oh, they must have taken his body. She sees angels. Oh, they must have taken his body. She sees Jesus. You must be the reason the tomb's empty. She's not wrong. Maybe you're kind of like Mary. I don't know what you got going on in your life. Probably all kinds of different things. Right? Disappointments, sadnesses, things that cause you shame, guilt, whatever. Marriage getting destroyed, relationships that are falling apart, guilt and shame that you can't bear, loneliness, addiction, depression, a terrible diagnosis, a loved one lost. And what can happen is all this stuff, this hopeless stuff kind of fills up your life, and that's all you see, a world of hopelessness, even when God, right in front of you, he says, "Look! But you know how Jesus got Mary out of her funk, right?
Mary. God still speaks today. He speaks through his word. He speaks through messengers. He's speaking right now. This is all God. This isn't me. Here's God speaking. He speaks to you and he says, friend, I live. Hope lives. One of the reasons hope lives, truth number two, the work of your salvation, your saving from sin, guilt, shame, death, the work of your salvation is finished. Because this is what happens. Jesus' last final words to her before he leaves, he says, go to my brothers and tell them I'm ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. I'm going to send and going to leave this world. Which, if you know anything about Jesus' mission on earth, maybe you know John 3:16. Probably you know John 3:16. For God so loved the world, he gave his only Son. Whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. Why did God give his Son? To win eternal life for us, right? To win our salvation. Which means Jesus is going to stay on earth until that mission is accomplished. And if he is telling Mary, time for me to go, guess what? Mission accomplished. The work's done. It is finished. You need to remember that, friends. Because it's easy to think it isn't. Kind of like prepping for Easter dinner. Any of y'all have an Easter dinner? Maybe you're hosting Easter dinner. If you are hosting Easter dinner and you're hosting family and relatives, perhaps you said to yourself, self, we should probably clean. Or maybe you said to your husband, you should probably clean. Right? We've got to clean up everything that's going on here. We've got to make it a little bit nicer. We've got to sweep the floor. Maybe you make a checklist. It could be even on your phone, right? A checklist. We've got to sweep the floor. We've got to vacuum. We've got to get rid of all the cat hair, right? We've got to clean the bathrooms. We've got to dust for cobwebs. We've got to go outside with a little tiny tweezers and make sure to pull every single weed. And you got a toothbrush on the corners. So we've got to make it looking real nice. And maybe you do that. You go out to shopping. And when you come back and you've got all the food ready, and your husband's there, he's on the couch. Well, office reruns weren't on the list? Sorry. No, honey, don't worry. I'm done. I did it all for you. It's all done. The whole list. It's all done. The whole list. It's all done. What do?
You start sweeping and vacuuming and cleaning all over again, right? Maybe that's like my life, maybe not yours, sorry. It's easy to feel like it's not really finished because you've got to be involved, you've got to do it yourself. When it comes to God, when it comes to his words, don't do that. It's finished, Jesus said on the cross, and in the resurrection he proves it. Which means it's not like I have to become perfect for God to like me. I do it to improve vastly. I've got to try and outweigh the good with the bad. This is a recipe for guilt and shame and burdens your whole life. That's not why Jesus came. He came to save, and his salvation work is done. Hear this. Because of Jesus, in Jesus, through faith in Jesus, my friend, you are forgiven. You're loved. And you will live. Which is why Easter's kind of the best day ever. Which leads us to part three. Go on, Sam. But isn't this interesting? Mary, when she sees Jesus, it says she holds on to him, which I can understand. She grabs him, maybe his feet, maybe she gives him a hug. She doesn't want that truth to leave her. She doesn't want to go back to her hopelessness. She wants to stay in her hopefulness. But Jesus says, don't hold on to me. Because Mary, there's others that need to hear this too. Here's the thing, you're not the only one dealing with this sadness. All those disciples, all of your friends, people, all everywhere. People 2,000 years in the future, in the Raleigh-Durham area, are going to need to hear this truth too. Go and tell. I bet you know someone who needs this. You might even see him later today. Hear God's word, share his message, share the reality of the resurrection with them. Share that hopefulness with them, because it's going to make all the difference. For instance, recently a friend of mine, her husband died. Which, that's pretty sad. You know, they turn to pastor, people turn to pastor for comfort. Here's the thing, you turn to pastor for comfort. I don't always know what I'm going to say. I don't always know what I'm going to do. Like, deep down, I'm like, I'm a little bit anxious. I'm a little bit nervous. I'm like, ah. But talking to the phone, like, I don't know if I've ever heard anyone so confident. Yeah, I'm sad, but I have some joy. Yeah, pastor, I'm going to miss him, but I'm okay. Why? Didn't you love him? Yeah. I'm going to be okay because Easter. Because Jesus. Because Jesus lives and he said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live even though he dies. Whoever lives and believes in me, listen to this, will never die. Jesus is the reason for hope. He's my reason. He's your reason. He's our friends and family's reason. Friends, he is our hope. My prayer today, we become eyewitnesses of this hope. We become eyewitnesses of this hope out in the world. Jesus, help us do this. Amen. We'll continue with our next song of praise. The song of praise is called This Joyful Easter Time. It's all about the truth of what happened on that first Easter morning. Please stand.